Hi everyone. In today's video, I want to talk about the difference between atomic and volatile within Java. These two concepts are a little difficult to differentiate sometimes, especially for newcomers to multithreading and concurrency. So today I want to differentiate the two with two different examples, one showing atomic and one showing volatile, and kind of showing the difference of why you'd want to do one versus the other in certain situations. At a high level, atomic means that you want a single unit to be able to do some work, such as a thread reading or writing to a variable. And then volatile means that you want to expose visibility of changes to a value to different threads. So two fundamentally different things that are often confused. I'm going to go ahead and pull up some code to try to deconflict them. Today's project we'll call volatile atomic. So the first thing I want to talk about is volatile. So all that volatile is it's a keyword that you can add onto a field. So let's say I want to make a private volatile int, my int, with a value of 2. And then I want to print out my int. Got to make it static. And we'll see when I run this code that it behaves just like normal ints. So as expected, we get the value 2 here. Okay, so what's the big deal? So we add this keyword, it doesn't really change the output. Well, volatile has a special meaning within the context of multithreading. So when you have a single-threaded program, the volatile keyword doesn't really get you anything. In fact, I'd probably argue it hampers performance. Really, the volatile keyword makes sense when you've got variables that need to be shared across threads. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to make a class that has a field that's going to get modified by multiple threads. And then I'm not going to mark it volatile, and you'll see what happens when we run that code. And then we'll switch it over to volatile and then see it work as expected. All right, so to talk through the code a little bit, I've got an instance of my unsafe class. I've got two threads going on here. The first thread is calling the loop method of my class, which loops 3 times, each time sleeping for a second. And I got a mark done as true there at the end. And then my second thread, which actually I can simplify this. I'm going to turn this into a method reference. A slightly more succinct way of describing the same behavior. So basically what this is doing is this is calling the wait to finish method. And what wait to finish is doing is it's waiting until the done variable is set to true, and then it's going to exit. Note that I am not using the volatile keyword here. This is just with regular usage like you might expect. So as soon as the loop method exits, we would expect the wait to finish to exit, because in our while done loop, we're essentially looping really, really fast right here, waiting until the variable done is set to true, and then we're going to exit. So let's go ahead and run the code and see what it does. Okay, so we can see that it entered wait to finish, and now after 3 seconds, it should be exiting, right? So it's past 3 seconds. Why isn't it exiting? So it seems that our program is hung. Let's go ahead and add in a few more log statements so we can try to see what's going on here. All right, so now we've got a print statement at the top of our loop method, and then we've got one right before we set done equal to true. Note that there are better ways to debug this, but for now I'm just going to use print statements just to show the behavior at a top level. So if I run this, we can see that we have entered wait to finish. Now we've set done to true, but we're still running. Okay, so what's going on here? Well, this is the beauty or annoyance of concurrent programming, whichever way you want to look at it. Basically, what's happening is when a thread starts executing its work, it has a local cache of various variables. And what it does is then it doesn't have to go and retrieve the program level value of a variable every single time. It can just look at its local cache. When you do that, though, and you have one thread that changes, let's say, this variable, then you've got another thread over here that's reading its own local cache. It's not going to know when this thread makes the change. So how do you fix that? Well, the thread that you have over here, you need to make sure that it is writing to a volatile member variable. Because when you write to something that is volatile, then any readers of that variable will read the latest write that has happened to that variable, and they're not going to read any sort of cached value. So basically what's happening is the operating system has local versions of each of these done variables just for different threads, but we need to have it read the same value. This is really unintuitive if you're new to concurrent programming, but basically all you have to do is you have to use the volatile keyword. And now that I know that I have a volatile keyword, when we compile the code, each thread will not cache this in a local cache. It will retrieve it each time, which might have a slight impact on performance of your application, but now you shouldn't run into this problem. Let's go ahead and run it again and see what we get. And there it goes. Interesting. So this is a really important point. Whenever you have mutable data members that are accessed across multiple threads, you need some way to protect reads and writes from them in some way. So we've talked about using synchronized. That enforces that one thread will execute a certain block of code at one particular time. And now we're talking about volatile, which increases the visibility of shared data members across multiple threads. Volatile does not fix the problem of atomic or atomic operations because it only enforces visibility. It doesn't do anything about enforcing that writes happen at only particular times. So to demonstrate that, I'm going to go ahead and change out this example, and I'm going to show that volatile versus not doesn't affect the code. All right, so we've now updated our code. We have 5 threads. And each thread is going to call the increment method on my class 10,000 times. So what this should do by the end is that we have called increment 50,000 times. So counter should equal 50,000 because we default initialized to 0 here. And let me go ahead and print out the value at the end. If we run this, we can see that we don't get anywhere close to 50,000. We actually only hit 32,000, about 64-65% of the way there. And what we can think is, oh, well, if we add the volatile keyword, that should do it, right? And you notice IntelliJ gave us a little warning here. Non-atomic operation on volatile field counter. So basically what this is saying is when you use the volatile keyword, if you want it to work as you would expect, you need to expect every operation on your volatile field is atomic. Because otherwise what happens is you have synchronization issues, even though your visibility issue has been fixed like we demonstrated previously. So IntelliJ is giving us a warning, but let's go ahead and ignore that warning for a second and see if it changes the result. All right, so we happen to get a little bit closer to 50,000, but that's still not the right answer. 42,000 is not 50,000. So we can fix this by adding synchronized and then getting rid of volatile. This will work. I'll demonstrate this. So that looks good. But synchronize is sometimes a little heavy for something like a counter if we just want to increment something. There's a better way to do that, and that is with atomic integers. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to make an atomic integer. I'm going to give it a default value of 0. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to say this counter increment and get, and then I'll say this.counter.get. You can read the documentation on atomic integer. Basically what it does is it guarantees that when we enter each of these methods, we are doing atomic operations. So each of these are going to be thread safe. So now what it's going to do is I can take the synchronized keyword out, and we're still going to get the result we want because we're going to use atomic integer here. So if I run the code, now we get what we want. Great. So now the next thing you might be wondering is, do I need to mark atomic integer as volatile? The short answer is no, and I'm going to explain why. Basically, when we add the volatile keyword, we are saying that we want all of our threads to not use local cache in order to change some sort of value. Now, what we're talking about is we're talking about the actual value, not the value that something points to. So if atomic integer were a primitive, then I 100% would need to use the volatile keyword. because atomic integer is an object reference and I'm not changing the value of the reference, just the data underneath the reference, I actually don't need the volatile keyword, and it'd be better if I used final. Because final says immutable. Immutability is the strong preference when you're dealing with concurrency, because then you don't need to worry about other things like volatile, synchronized, etc., because you have data immutability. And when you're dealing with shared data, it's really mutable data that you need to be concerned about. So in this case, it's better to use final for an object reference, because if you were to make an object reference volatile, then that would mean that you must be changing the object reference itself, not the data that the object reference points to. And that was an overview of the difference between atomic and volatile. My hope is that you came out of this video with more answers than questions. Feel free to let me know in the comments below where you ended up. Thank you for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.